Upanishad series, surrender, the essence of trust, the outcome of trust. There is a question, is surrender to God or surrender to a master is the same? Whenever the question comes of surrender, we always look for the object. For surrender, no object is necessary. Surrender refers to your trust is in unknown and unknowable. Every moment a circumstance and situation comes, it always comes to you as new, unknown, something that you have never experienced before. And how much do you trust that circumstance and situation, or the person, or whatsoever happens in a moment as unknown and unknowable, will determine, will be solely responsible for your surrender. You can surrender implies trust in the unknown and unknowable. It has nothing to do with the object, but our focus remains on the object. Surrender does not depend on object. It is the quality that you bring in your being. Surrender is the quality that you bring into your being. To whom you surrender is irrelevant. I repeat it. Surrender is the quality that you bring to your being. Surrender is the quality that you bring to your being. To whom you surrender is not important. It is irrelevant. Any object can do. You can surrender to a tree. You can surrender to a river. In fact, you can surrender to anything, your wife, your husband, your child, or any inanimate object as well. The problem is not there in the object. Any object will do. The problem is to surrender. The happening or the essence of surrendering happens because of surrendering, not because of to whom you have surrendered. And this is the most beautiful thing to understand. Indeed, to whomsoever you surrender, sentient or insentient, that object becomes God. There is no question of surrendering to God or to a master. Where would you find God to surrender? You will never find. Just surrender. And to whoever or whomsoever you surrender, remember, God is there revealing to you in pristine glory and qualities. Only you need to have the eyes. The child becomes the God. The husband becomes the God. The wife becomes God. The master becomes the God. Even a stone can become the God. And this people cannot understand. When a Hindu worships the stone, it is a symbol, but he focuses on the ritualistic aspect. You surrender, and that is important. Then for the first time you understand the relevance or the meaning of the word omnipresence, omnipotent and omniscient. Until then, these are empty words for you. Even through stones, there are people who have attained. Because it is not a question at all to what or whom you surrender. You surrender, and that brings the whole thing. And the magnificence that opens the door. Surrendering, the effort to surrender, brings an opening to you. Your surrendering, the effort to surrender, opens infinite possibility. And if you are open to a stone, that becomes door to you to the existence, because it is only a question of opening. For surrender, all that matters is, are you open to the unknown and unknowable? How can you be open to a stone and not to a tree? Once you know the art of opening, once you enjoy the euphoria that it brings, euphoria that opening brings, the ecstasy that happens just by opening to a stone, to an unknown and unknowable situation, and then you cannot find such a foolish person who will close immediately to the remaining existence. When even opening to a stone gives you such ecstatic experience, then why not open to all? This is the ultimate in surrendering. Once you open to one object, even a stone, and you understand the very euphoria, the ecstasy of surrendering, the ecstasy of opening yourself, it releases tremendous pressure from you. It opens to you to an unknown realm, something that you cannot imagine. This is the ultimate in surrendering. And once you have known the art, then you can surrender to the whole existence. In the beginning, someone surrenders to something, and then he is surrendered to all. All means the entire existence. That is the meaning, that if you surrender to a master, in the experience of surrendering, you have learned a clue. The basic clue, the master key. Now you can surrender to all. The master becomes just a passage or a door to be passed through. Sikhs have called their place of worship as Gurudwara. It comes from two words, Guru and Dwara. It does give two meanings. Dwara means through, and Guru means the master. Through the master, you reach to that realm. Through the master, you attain to surrender. This is one meaning. Indeed, you need something to begin the journey. The other is Guru, Dwar, remove the vowel. Then means master is the door. Indeed, master is the door, and the two meanings combine. Master is the door, and through the door you enter. When the two meanings of Gurudwara and Gurudwar are combined together, you understand master is the door. When you are entering through a building, through a room, you enter through the door, you exit through the door. You cannot walk through the walls. You cannot walk through anything opaque. Master is not opaque. You can walk through and through him. And when you have learned the art of walking through the master, you consider him as a door. You reach to open a space. If you surrender to a master, in the experience of surrendering, you have learned a clue. Now you can surrender to the entire existence. Master becomes just a passage or a door to be passed through. He becomes a door. And through that door, you can look at the whole sky. When you visit a new city, you have entered your hotel room late in the night. It's a cold winter night, still you want to see an outside glimpse. You remove the curtain a little bit to get the glimpse of outside. Through the window you do get the glimpse, but this glimpse is the faint image of the outside. Just as when you look at a picture, the picture may be still or it may be alive, but it is only a framed image. So when through the window you look at the outside, it is a framed image. So master, the journey of surrender begins with the master as the framed image. He gives you the first glimpse of your innerness, of the vast openness. And then he gives you tremendous courage and encourages you to come under the open sky. And when you come under the open sky, under the stars, under the moon, under the sun, you feel the vastness of it. And then you can surrender to all. He becomes a door, and through that door, you can look at the whole sky. Remember, you cannot find God to surrender. But many people think that way, and this is erroneous. They think only when God is there, we will surrender, or we can only surrender the way Arjun did it to Krishna. These are all foolishness. Now, it is impossible because God is there only if you surrender. God is embedded in your very act of surrendering. God is embedded in your surrender. Surrender makes everything godly. Surrender makes everything godly. It gives you the eye, and everything that comes in front of these eyes becomes divine. Everything that comes in front of it becomes the divine. Then, whatsoever you see, sentient or insentient, you see something sparkling from behind it. Surrender gives you the eyes, the vision, the understanding, the awakening. And everything that comes in front of these eyes becomes divine. Divinity, divineness, is the quality given by surrendering. In India, Christians, Jews, Mohammedans laugh about Hindus because they may be worshipping a tree or a stone, not even carved as a stone. They can find a stone by the side of the road and they can make a god out of it immediately. Worship of Shiva is the easiest and the easiest way. Any stone, you place it and you consecrate it, it becomes the symbol of your worship. No artist is needed because surrender in itself is the art of arts. Surrender in itself is the art of arts, the deepest. No carving or a valuable stone is needed, not even marble. Any ordinary stone discarded that cannot be sold in the market, and hence it is lying there by the roadside, and Hindus can make immediately a god out of it. If you can surrender, it becomes divine. Even if you cannot surrender to a most expensive marble statue, that it's meaningless. If you can surrender, it becomes divine. The eyes of surrender cannot find anything else other than the divine. Your whole gestalt changes. Your vision changes, and when whatsoever you look at, you find divinity in it. And the very essence of surrender is finding that vision, that in everything you find a quality of the divine. It is not important how many verses of Bhagavad Gita you understand. It is not important how many dohas and chaupais of Ramayana or Ramcharitmanas you understand. If you can bring a single quality of Ram into you, and that alone gives you the eyes. How did you respond to a particular circumstance and situation? That alone becomes the door to you. And that is that eye, that vision, that understanding is given to you by surrender. Others have laughed because they could not understand. They think that these people are stone or idol worshippers, and that is the greatest ignorance, religious ignorance, in the name of which many atrocities have happened. They are not idol worshippers. Hindus have been misunderstood over the period of history by the ignorant ones who consider themselves to be wise and they do not understand. During the time of Ramakrishna Paramahansa, when Vivekananda stayed with him, there was a person named Kalu. He had almost 300 stones. Every day he will bathe them. To him, each stone was alive. And Ramakrishna never stopped him. A master never stops. Instead, he allows the things to happen naturally. You remember Everyone needs a teddy bear, a child. When child's emotions are hurt, she needs someone to narrate her feelings to. She uses the teddy bear to narrate all her problems that she feels. And the teddy bear has become her entire world, everything for her. But as she grows, one day she leaves the teddy bear. It is meaningless. All those dolls that she used to spend time with are meaningless now. This has to be allowed. So master never allow anything unnatural. Instead, they allow these teddy bears to be worshipped. It happened, Vivekananda was continuing his sadhana around the ashram. One day he told, he was sitting in meditation and he directed Kalu to go and throw all these stones into the river Ganges that flowed near the ashram. Because Vivekananda was man of meditation, Ramakrishna intuitively knew it. He called Kalu. What are you going to do that? Do. Kalu said all of a sudden he was in meditation, he was doing his worship, and a thought flashed his mind that go and drown all these stones in the river. Ramakrishna knew it. He told Kalu, you continue to do your things. Then he called Vivekananda and he told him, why did you do that? And it is not good to disturb the process of growth of an individual. Everyone has to walk in his own feet. Kalu has to go through this process of teddy bears, and then one day these teddy bears will slip out of his hand and then he will reach to the next stage. He said, from now onwards you will not get the glimpses of samadhi. Then Vivekananda begged him and he said, it will be only 3 days before your death that you will experience that. And it happened 3 days before his final dissolution. He locked up himself into the room. No one was allowed, and that process completed. The eyes of surrender cannot find anything other than the divine. It is a vision, it is a gloom, it is the, like your eyes have become a magnified glass that can only see divinity. Others have laughed because they could not understand. They think that these people are stone worshippers or idol worshippers. They are not. Hindus have been misunderstood over the period of time by the ignorant ones. They are not idol worshippers. Instead, they have found an essential key. This is the key. The key is of you can make anything divine if you surrender. This is the master key. The art of making anything divine is the master key, and that is the essence of surrender. If you do not surrender, then you can go on searching for God for millions of lives. You will never meet Him because you do not have the quality which can find. So the question is of subjective surrender, not of the object, to whom to surrender, or things like these. But of course, there are problems. You cannot so suddenly surrender to a stone because your mind goes on saying it is just a stone. What are you? When it comes to surrendering the master, how can I surrender to a man? Your mind goes on saying this is just a stone, what are you doing? And if the mind goes on saying this is a stone, what are you doing? Then you cannot surrender. Surrender needs your totality, a state when the mind is no more there. You will recall 8-year-old Adi Shankar was found wandering in the Himalayan mountains. Imagine one who was born and grew up in the southernmost tip of India, and on a cold winter early morning he was found wandering in the Himalayan mountains. How did he? If you just imagine, how did this 8-year-old boy who has taken the monkhood reached from Kerala, the southernmost tip of India, to the Himalayan mountains? Did he fly? Did somebody magically put him there? And there he meets Govind Padacharya. He asks him, "Who are you?" And Shankar composed the famous Nirvan Shatkam. Mano buddhi ahankar chittani naham. Mano buddhi ahankar chittani naham. I am neither the mind, nor the intellect, nor the ego sense, nor the storehouse of the memory. And he continues in 6 compositions. He completes the entire message. He is neither the mind, nor the intellect, nor the ego sense, nor the storehouse of the memory. These are the 4 corners through which the mind operates. Surrender needs your totality. Hence, there is the significance of the master. A master means someone who is standing on the threshold of the human and the divine. He looks like you. Very much he looks like you. But he is you plus something else. And that which is plus something else is beyond your cognition. You cannot see his innerness. You can only see through his eyes. A master means someone who is standing on the threshold of the human and the divine. You remember when, imagine a threshold. You will recall the incident from the scriptures when the nursing avatar took place. Hiranyakashipu was given a boon that he will not be killed inside or outside. But this is what we understand, you cannot kill me inside or outside, but there is something in between the two. And in between the two is a very delicate threshold. And that threshold where you are neither inside nor outside. When you lie down in the night on your bed, you place your head on the pillow, you are neither asleep nor waking. A moment comes when you are, one realm is leaving and giving place to the other, a very delicate moment. That very delicate moment, when one realm is leaving and you are entering into the other, is known as threshold. How would you define when one moment dissolves into the other? It happens in a flash. If you can imagine a drop merging into the ocean, how long does it take when it has merged into the ocean? And this moment is so precise that you cannot put into the words. A master means somebody who is standing on the threshold of the human and the divine. One who has been human being like you, but no more like you. Something else has happened. He is a plus, a human being plus divine. So if you look into his past, he is just like you. But if you look into his present and the future, then you can look at this plus. Then he is the divine. And most of the people look at the past alone. And then neither surrender is possible, and without surrender, transformation is not possible. Surrender is the beginning of transformation. Surrender is the key to the process of transformation. It is difficult to surrender to a stone or a river. Even to surrender a master is so difficult. Then surrendering to a stone is bound to be not only difficult, instead impossible as well. Because whenever you see a master, then again your mind says that this is a human being like you. He may have his weaknesses, he may have his desires, because you cannot see beyond your own mind. You have your mind, your own way of looking at the things. And there is a famous saying, we see things as we are, not as they are. Whenever you see a master, then again your mind says that this is a human being just like you. And you know his past, so why surrender to him? And your mind cannot see the present moment. And that you can do only by looking into his eyes. The oceanic presence is there. You can drown into it. A very look into the eyes of the master gives you the intoxication, and your mind cannot see the present. Mind can only see the past, and mind lives in the past of this man who is born like you, eats like you, sleeps like you, and also has done so many wrong things that you know. So why surrender to him? He's just like you. He is, and yet he is not. He is both Jesus and Christ. Jesus is the Son of Man, and Christ becomes the Son of God. And that is the plus point. If you watch only the visible, then he is a stone, and then you cannot surrender. If you love, if you become intimate, if you allow his presence to go deep in you, if you can find a rapport, indeed rapport with his being, then suddenly you become aware of the plus. He is more than human. In some unknown ways, he has something that you have not yet got. In some invisible ways, he has penetrated beyond the boundaries of the human. But this you can feel. This beyondness, only if there is a rapport. There is a deep connectivity between you and him, a bond. And that is what Patanjali calls as Shraddha or trust. Certainly trust creates that rapport. Rapport is the inner harmony of the two invisibles. Love is a rapport. With somebody, you simply fit as if you both are born for each other. You call it love. In a moment, even at the first sight, someone simply fits with you as if you were created together and were separated somehow, and now you have met again. This is Shraddha, far more than love. If you sanctify love, if you transcend love beyond the needs of the body, beyond the desires, you enter into a vast horizon, and that vast horizon of love is Shraddha or trust. In the old mythologies all over the world, it is said that man and woman were created together. In Indian mythology, they have a very beautiful myth. Myth is that a wife and a husband were created in the very beginning as twins, brothers. Brother and sister. Together they were born, wife and husband as twins, fitting together in one womb. There was a rapport from the very beginning. They were together in the womb, holding each other, and that is the rapport. Then, due to some misfortune, that phenomena discontinued from the earth. This is the beginning, the first aspect of the surrender. Then the second aspect of surrender is Shraddha.